Jesus, this is rest. Peace, perfect peace, with loved ones far away. In Jesus' keeping we are safe.
Scriptures tell us in Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2 to fix our eyes upon Jesus. To fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. It's this time of the year that the world of Christianity stops and focuses on this week, this particular week. Some have called it Passion Week. Others have called it Holy Week. It's the week of leading up to Jesus' crucifixion, his final week physically here on earth in his ministry before his resurrection and ascended to the throne. This very week, I want us to know that 1,988 years ago, this very week, something very, very important was taking place, something of eternal importance. And I want us tonight to take a moment to reflect on this week of Jesus, to take time to remember the days that transpired, the events that transpired. We're going to look at four of those days tonight, and then next Wednesday night, we'll look at four more. During this time period, it's the most important week of the world, leading up to the most important event to ever take place in the history of humankind. I've called tonight's lesson, The Joy Set Before Him, based on Hebrews 12 and verse 2, and what a week it was. This was the beginning of the week where Jesus was crucified. It was the beginning of the week of God's greatest work, the salvation of mankind, of all who would respond. It was the beginning of the week of the finished work of Christ on the cross, the week that changed the world, the week that changed me, the week that changed you. And when the details are all put together of Jesus' ministry, looking at all the Gospels, the Bible reveals only really 40-plus days of Jesus' actual events and work in the life of Christ. Yet the details of this week, this final week, take more pages than any of the other events in Jesus' ministry. What Jesus did in this one week consumes one-third of the Gospels. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. What Jesus did in this week makes up one half of the Gospel of John. The mere space that's given to this event in Jesus' life this week tells us just how important it is. The final eight chapters of Matthew's 28 chapters are dedicated to this. The last six chapters of Mark's 16 chapters are dedicated to this. And the final six chapters of Luke's 24 are dedicated to this. And amazingly, John dedicates 10 of his 21 chapters to this week, this final week of Jesus' ministry, his betrayal, his trials, his crucifixion, his burial in the tomb, and his triumphant resurrection. Even Acts, which gives details about the history of the early church, reflects on the events of this week seven different times. While the pages of the Old Testament anticipate this week, prophesy about this week, look forward to the events of this week, the pages of the New Testament look back. Look back and reflect upon the week and the implications of Jesus' finished work on the cross and what was accomplished. So I want to focus our hearts and minds tonight on these events, always remembering that as we fix our eyes on Jesus, we remember the timeless truth that regardless, no matter what's going on in this world, Jesus is still reigning. He is our resurrected King. One thing I would encourage all of us to do during this time period, when the world pauses and thinks about these things, and the hearts seem to be more open to the reality of who Jesus is and what his work was on the cross, I think it's helpful to look back in the Gospels and read these events. And I would encourage you to maybe open up Matthew, read chapters 21 to 28, or Mark chapters 11 through 16, or Luke chapters 19 through 24, John chapters 12 through 21. Because the Passover has a date in the Scriptures, and we know when it was celebrated every year, it enables us to recognize the actual dating of when these events took place. The week began, first of all, on Sunday, March the 29th in 33 AD. Some have called that Sunday Palm Sunday, and the reason will be clear pretty soon. But the first event that took place on that Sunday was the anointing of Jesus. He was at Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, and as they were sitting, reclining for the meal, Mary came out and anointed Jesus' feet with the expensive oil, nard, that would have been approximately a year's wages for someone, a common worker at that time period. Such an elaborate, expensive gift, anointing Jesus' feet out of gratitude for what he had done. The next event that took place was the triumphal entry. Jesus had never allowed such a praise welcome when he would come into a city or a place, although crowds would gather around him. This was something that had not happened. But in this case, he's coming into town and he's made preparations to ride on the colt of a donkey that had never been ridden. And Matthew actually tells us there were two animals, the donkey and the colt together. Perhaps it was the mother there to keep the colt stable. We don't know. But he chose this praise welcome, this triumphal entry as he comes on a colt of a donkey riding into town as King of the Jews. An event that had not happened since Solomon rode into Jerusalem there on the back of a donkey. No war horse. No, he comes in on a borrowed colt, never been ridden, not to have ever been ridden before. He comes as a humble king, and the people spread branches out and place their cloaks out, and as he's coming through, they're shouting Hosanna, which means, save us, we pray. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. There were also some Greeks who were there for the Passover as Jesus approached town, and they asked him questions. John doesn't tell us what their questions were, but Jesus responded by revealing that he was soon to be crucified. It tells us in John 12, verse 17, Jesus says, "Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour?" No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. And then Jesus said, "Father, glorify your name." And then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there heard it and said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Here, this third time that God speaks from heaven, declaring first, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased," declaring on the Mount of Transfiguration, "This is my Son, listen to him." And now declaring that, yes, the Lamb will be crucified. The Lamb will be sacrificed for the sins of the people. And the voice spoke from heaven, and all who were there heard it. It's at this point that Jesus weeps over Jerusalem. He cries and he says, "Oh, Jerusalem, if you had only known that which would give you peace is now here, but you have rejected it, you've resisted it." It tells us that he goes and visits the temple. In fact, Mark 11 says, Jesus entered Jerusalem and he went into the temple courts and he looked around at everything. But since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. What did Jesus see when he went into the temple courts? It was already evening time. It was late, but what he sees sets the stage for what's soon to happen. The second day, day two, is Monday, March 30th, 33 AD. He gets up in the morning, and as he's making the trip back to Jerusalem, he sees a fig tree in leaf. He went to it out of hunger, disappointed to find no fruit. And in the Old Testament, Israel is often pictured as the fig tree. But in this case, the fig tree is bearing no fruit. There's no fruit at all. And an object lesson is given there of this nation of Israel never producing what was intended. Jesus' very next stop is to go straight into Jerusalem. And it's here that Jesus cleanses the temple. He knows exactly what he's going to find when he comes into the temple courts. He's going to find money changers. He's going to find merchants buying and selling goods. The temple area was to be revered. It was, in this case, though, being abused and neglected. The people were using it as a shortcut to make their way through Jerusalem. The temple tax to be paid by the people had to be paid in the Hebrew shekel. But people who had traveled would arrive with a Roman denarii or a Greek drachma, and they had to exchange those funds in order to get the Hebrew shekel. And what was taking place was the money changers were charging exorbitant amounts of money, of tax, in order to change that money into the Hebrew shekel. It was corruption. To make matters worse, they were taking those animals which were to be sacrificed during the Passover, unblemished animals, and they were selling the inferior animals to make a profit on those who were there, those pilgrims who had traveled for the Passover. Jesus overturned the tables, it said. He saw what was taking place in righteous indignation. He said, Mark 11, verse 15 says, "On reaching Jerusalem, Jesus entered the temple courts and began driving out those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those who were selling doves. Would not allow anyone to carry merchandise through the temple courts." And as he taught them, as all this is going on, he's teaching them, saying, "Is it not written, 'My house will be called a house of prayer for all nations'? But you have made it into a den of robbers." Jesus had now arrived in Jerusalem, and there is no turning back. He has set the stage. He has now confronted what he sees taking place in the temple, the corruption, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, those who were there buying and selling. There's no turning back now for Jesus. He didn't go to Jerusalem to become man of the year or to receive the Nobel Peace Prize. No, he came to be our Savior. And he's now, as Luke says, set his face towards Jerusalem. He has now arrived. That evening came, and he left Jerusalem and went back to Bethany. The third day, Tuesday, March 31st, 33 AD. This day would have been the last day of Jesus' earthly ministry there in Jerusalem. And it would be his last day physically in the temple. Of all the days recorded in the scriptures, Tuesday was the busiest day in the life of Christ based upon what the gospel records report. He arrived early there in the city of Jerusalem, and he did not leave Jerusalem to go back to Bethany until late that night. It's amazing the amount of teaching, parables, events that transpired on this day of ministry in the life of Jesus. That morning when they left Bethany, Peter was completely shocked because he was amazed by the sudden death of the fig tree. He said, "Teacher, the fig tree you cursed yesterday is withered." And Jesus used that opportunity. Not only was there the object lesson of what was soon to take place to Israel, 70 AD, and its destruction, but also the teaching opportunity of Jesus when he says, "Have faith in God." Jesus taught three parables that day. First of all, actually in total, he taught six parables, but that morning, Jesus taught three parables first. It was the parable of two sons, the parable of the wicked tenants, and the parable of the marriage feast, showing how many would resist the invitation of Jesus. All three of these parables were taught to those who were listening in the temple courts, and they were a direct finger-pointing. The parable of the two sons about a lack of repentance, the parable of the wicked tenants, those who God had owned the vineyard but gave the vineyard out to tenants, and they never would produce any fruit, and people were sent, servants were sent to collect, but they would beat them up. And then finally, the owner sends his own son, and says that they killed him. What should be done with the vineyard? Jesus asked in the parable. These parables had a bite to them. Instruction, calling for repentance, but they were falling on ears that were unwilling to repent. It was after these parables that the debates began, many debates, as Pharisees, Sadducees, and Herodians would come to Jesus, trying to take his teachings, trying to question him, trying to trap him in his words. It was here that Jesus was questioned about giving taxes to Caesar. He holds up a coin. He says, whose image is this? Whose inscription? In fact, it tells us in Mark 12, Jesus responded when they said it was Caesar's inscription, "Give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's." And they were amazed at him. Jesus, knowing that his death was only days away, here teaching to give to Caesar what is Caesar's, give to God what is God's. The very people who would soon crucify him were employed by Caesar. And even though Caesar's soldiers would ultimately nail him to the cross, Jesus still said, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar." It was on this day that Jesus was questioned about what is the greatest command. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second like it, Jesus said, love your neighbor as yourself. It was at this point that Jesus delivered a very pointed sermon to these Pharisees, the Sadducees, the Herodians, but especially the Pharisees. That sermon's given to us in Matthew 23. Matthew's the only one who gives to us what is the most scathing sermon that Jesus ever delivered. When he called these Jewish leaders snakes, he called them whitewashed walls, he called them blind guides. It's here that he delivers the seven woes. This sermon is directed at these who belong to God, who God had done so much for as part of his vineyard, but who never produced a thing. And it's at this point that Jesus weeps for Jerusalem. "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem," he says, "how I have longed to gather you like a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were unwilling." Then Jesus, as his disciples begin to ask him questions about the temple and what large stones they are, Jesus begins to tell them about the destruction of Jerusalem and about the end times. "When will these things be?" they ask. And Jesus here delivers these details about not only the destruction of Jerusalem, what to look for when these things will happen, but the destruction of the end time of the world. Both are taking place in this chapter of Matthew 24. Jesus would deliver three more parables then, the 10 virgins talking to his disciples, the parable of the talents, and the parable of the sheep and the goats about judgment, and all six parables on this day. So much teaching taking place. No one has ever existed before and has ever existed again to teach like Jesus taught, to preach like Jesus would preach. But his preaching fell on deaf ears. What a day this was for Jesus. Interestingly, amidst all of the hypocrisy of that day, God sent a most beautiful object lesson. There in the temple earlier that day, God sent this humble widow who there in the midst of all of the hypocrisy, all the greed, would put in two mites. Jesus, seeing that widow, took this opportunity to teach his disciples something that they would never forget, something so profound. All these rich people putting in everything they had, or putting in money, not all that they had, but putting in large amounts, Mark would say. But this widow putting in two mites, all that she had to live on. And Jesus taught them she put in more than the others because of her sacrifice, helping the disciples understand what true giving really is. That was Tuesday, the third day. The fourth day, Wednesday, April 1st, 33 AD. Interestingly enough, the Bible record is silent about the events of Wednesday. The actions, the words of Jesus that take place, we know nothing of. We don't know where he was on Wednesday. We don't know where he went or who he saw on Wednesday. But we do know that the plots against him were beginning to take place. They were beginning to come to fruition there, as Jesus may have not taught that day. We don't know. But Judas was very busy that day. In fact, his betrayal was not impulsive. It was deliberate. As he went and he met with the chief priests to make arrangements, the Sanhedrin also on this day was the Jewish high council meeting in secret session. Satan too was busy bringing together all that was needed, this plot to end the life of Jesus. Judas would go and for 30 pieces of silver agree to betray Jesus. One thing that we do know that happened Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday is the Bible tells us that Jesus was going back to Bethany, going to Jerusalem, and then going back to Bethany. One thing Jesus did, would have to do to leave Jerusalem and from the temple and go back to Bethany, he would have to travel through the Kidron Valley. You can see what the Kidron Valley looks like here. This is the modern image of it, the walls there of Jerusalem and that valley that comes below. As Jesus would leave Jerusalem, the temple, he would travel through that valley to make his way up towards Bethany. The name Kidron means gloomy, shadow, or dark. And it was here in this valley that Jesus would walk through this area of gloom, of dark, no doubt thinking through the events that were soon to transpire as he would be betrayed, as he would go through the suffering, as he would say that the cup that he was about to drink was about to take place. This was the time period of the Passover, and sacrifices were happening every day in the temple. Maybe you're wondering, where did all the blood go from those sacrifices? God gave very specific instructions with where that blood was to flow there in the temple area, on the ground, at the base of the altar. Underneath that temple area, there were drainage systems that were set up that would collect that blood, and it would all flow down into the Kidron Valley. You can see on this map, where did the blood flow? It would flow out during this time of year into that valley. There was already a brook there in the Kidron Valley, but then the blood mixing with it, so much blood, as animal after animal, sacrifice after sacrifice would take place. As Jesus walked through that Kidron Valley, his sandals, his feet, the edge of his garment even bloodied by the blood, the water there. As he walked through, he must have remembered the blood covenant. He must have remembered the blood covenant that he had made with Abraham so many years before. The blood covenant there where God appeared to Abraham and said, bring a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old, with a dove and a young pigeon, all the animals that would be one day used in the temple sacrifice, all the animals that were being sacrificed there at that time of Jesus as he's there in the Passover. The blood of those same animals that are mentioned here in Genesis when that event takes place, it's also the blood, the same animal blood that was trickling down into the Kidron Valley that God had given special instructions to gather those animals, and Abraham opened up the animals and sacrificed them into a certain format so that the blood would flow down into this almost a little brook area there with those animals. That evening, it tells us in Genesis that a deep trance fell on Abraham and he was suddenly in a dreadful darkness, and there appeared these burning coals in this flaming torch, and both those items, the burning coals, representative of God himself, and the torch, and God himself walked through that path of blood, the blood path, making a covenant, promising Abraham that I'm going to give you a son, I'm going to give you a people, I'm going to give you a land, and one day the world will be blessed. All the world will be blessed through you. Well, God had already given a son and a people and a land. And God's just about to complete the promise, the covenant. And as he's walking through the blood that Abraham sacrificed, there is a blood covenant that's being made that's promising Abraham there will be a Savior. There will be someone who comes, who's prophesied, the Messiah, the anointed one who will bless the world. As Jesus walked through, Jesus must have remembered that day so many years ago as he walked through the blood. Now here he is walking through the Kidron Valley, knowing that the time has arrived, the hour is at hand, the cup he must soon drink. He would say in Mark 9:31 that he would be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him, and after 3 days, he will arise. Tonight, may we be filled with the wonder, with the amazement, with the awe of just how deep the Father's love is for us. That Jesus, the fulfillment of the promises that would all take place here at this time, just as was promised by God so many years before. Yes, let us be filled with wonder and awe at the deep love the Father has for us, and let us be reminded anew of the love of Christ. Yes, let's fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Let's pray. Father, we do remember the great promises you have made to us through the years, through your word, the great promises that you fulfilled in the life of Christ. And here at this same time of the year, as we think about this week, the events of Jesus, the things he taught leading up to the crucifixion, the resurrection of Jesus, we're reminded of just how deep your love is for us. Tonight, Father, we fix our eyes on your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Thank you for the example of Jesus who, for the joy that was set before him, went to the cross, the shame of the cross enduring its scorn. It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
I still have.